question than looking at yourself?
Yes, you can start.
Okay, thank you very much. You are welcome. My name is Neo Mbata. I'm coming from Emakhosini Valley. That's a valley of the kings. That is where the Zulu kingdom started during the period of 1600. So just like here, we've got this village which is known as Umgungundlovu. There's a secret meeting place of an elephant. Like the word elephant, that is a metaphor when it comes to King Dingane. As we deal with King Dingane, as a half-brother to King Shaka. There's the one who killed King Shaka just for power. So his village was established a long time. That was in 1829. Then it was destroyed or burnt it down after so many fights and battles, especially during the land issues. That was in 1838. We just discovered the site and then renewed the village. That was in 1990. So it was built between two streams. That is Mkumbane. Then on the other side, that is Unzololo. So what is most interesting is that King Dingane was very suspicious. He didn't drink the water from around. He preferred the water collected at Mtonjaneni. That might be 8 kilometers away. Back into the village, very well structured, very well organized. Divided into three sections. That's the warriors section. Then on the other side, we've got the two sections. That is a white and black section for only 500 wives of the king, because the King Dingane was having 500 wives but no children as a result, because he thought he might be overpowered by his own kids. So then the village was just measured into 600 by 500 meters. So here that was the main entrance. So then this portion only for festivals, gatherings, and so on. Okay, thank you very much. So just here we talk about the formation of the Zulu kingdom. As in 1600 long time, we've got this guy by the name of Zulu, who is just considered as the progenitor. Okay, thank you. So this Zulu is the progenitor, founder of the Zulu clan. Also, that is the first chief of the Zulus, as all of the Zulu nation has been named after him. So he's lying, he's just buried around here at this place, Emakhosini. That is where the Zulu kingdom was formed, as I explained. So more Zulu kings are just buried here. Zulu is the first one, then he got these people until that one, King Senzangakhona, who gave birth into these three important Zulu kings, King Shaka, Dingane, and Mbande. Those three half-brothers, we learned that they just killed each other for becoming the kings. We know that King Shaka was killed by Dingane in 1828. Then Dingane was also killed by the people from somewhere there at Ingwavuma, Swaziland, with the strong help from King Dingane's brother Mbande. That was in 1840. Then Mbande followed. So then Mbande got this Cetshwayo just down to the bottom, where we've got this King Goodwill Zwelithini. That is the current Zulu king. Stays somewhere there at Nongoma. That is on the northern part of KwaZulu. So he's having about 5 wives and then added a number of children. Therefore, when it comes into the Zulu culture, when the current king dies, there's going to be the first son from the first wife who married in traditional to lead the Zulu nation or to become the Zulu king. Okay, so this just the sort of the highlights about the Zulu kingdom, or in fact about the formation of the Zulu kingdom. So if you can maybe come and pay a visit, that is where you can get much more information about what we are doing, in fact. Thank you. To the folk records, in fact, you talk about the people originally, I think, from all the way in Dutch or maybe Holland, Netherlands, all the way from abroad. So those people we talk about, they came into this particular Zululand or maybe in South Africa as for getting a piece of land, especially from this King Dingane. And then they came into this land, there were about 70 of them. Then their leader was Peter Retief. They got involved with this King Dingane. Then Dingane explained what's going to be taking place. Then he promised them with the land, but under a certain condition about recovering of the stolen cattle. As a result, the land will be given. So we find that when the time goes on, those number of the fold records, they went there. Then they recovered the cattle from that particular guy. They brought them back into Dingane. Then, as a result, Dingane didn't give them the land. Instead, killed all of them. And then they were killed somewhere next to this place, Umgungundlovu. That was 6 February 1838. As a result, Dingane sent the other warriors or his Imbis to go in and attack the Boer encampments all the way towards Blaukranswinnen and Escort. That was February, March, April. As a result, Andries Pretorius, which is the other Boer leader, being reported by Reverend Francis Owen, so he got so angry about the issue. Then he collected the other Boers to come and pay the revenge into this Dingane. They were somewhere there in Blood River where Dingane heard that they were then planning to attack him. So as a result, more Zulus were just killed there in Blood River. As a result, this Nkomolovo, Dingane's village, in fact, was just demolished. It was burnt down in 1838. Then Dingane moved on further north of Zululand, all the way somewhere there in Swaziland. That's where we explained that he got murdered.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. So these are some artifacts or this kind of the stuff discovered up to the site into King Dingane's royal residence. We just discovered them, like these copper neck rings, of which they say that these things were worn by the ladies. And then over there, I've got something like a solidified porridge found inside the pot. That is incredible, because when they were burning the village, everything was burnt. So that is the stuff which is the original has been kept. So if we can maybe go down here, we've got this iron hoose blade, of which the stuff especially was used by the Zulu people for digging their medicines as a result. So instead, that is when they were just plowing for lima, for farming and all of the stuff. And then pieces of baked hard floors. So I will explain much more about the pieces of baked hard floors over there into the site. Then here we've got this man by the name of Francis Owen. Sorry, that is Alan Gardner. This is Alan Gardner. That was the guy who was like a missionary. Also, he was like a captain who arrived in 1834 for land survey in King Dingane's time. So there was a misunderstanding between him and Dingane. So shortly he moved back. I think that was in London when he published the book which was dealing about the period of King Dingane. He published a book which is Journey to the Zulu Country. That was in 1836. Thank you. So this is the picture of King Dingane. As mentioned, that he was the half brother to King Shaka. So this was not a strong warrior. He was not interested in going and fight with the people. In most cases, he was in the village. So designing the clothes for the wives, composing or compiling the songs, he was not like a Dingane. So he was very favorable. I mean, he was so interested in keeping pets like dogs, snakes, cats, and so on. So he's sitting on his nice chair. Thank you very much. So here we are just exactly into King Dingane's village. I mentioned that this is Mgungundlovu. So I mentioned that Mgungundlovu was burnt in 1838, and then this is just like the remain. So this is like the original hard floor from 1829. So what is good is that it still exists. So the floor was made out of the cow dung, the termite soil, plus the mixture of an animal blood. So it is strong, or it is baked like a cement, because everything was just bent down. So the fire make the floors to be baked. So that thing on the center, it's a fire making place. That is where they were cooking. They were also making fire when it was cold outside. Okay, thank you. Okay,
right.
So just now, the first of all, this area we're standing on, it's a dancing area that was used by King Dingane. As I explained, that King Dingane was a very good dancer. So as I said, that he was owning about 500 wives. So that is where they were always entertaining. Okay, so we've got these back huts here. That is a white section used by only the 400 less privileged wives of the king. So, and then the other 100 wives, of which were staying somewhere else. Okay, so then over there, just over there, we've got the hill that is a Singonyama, or the Lion Hill. Then at the foot of the hill, there was a place which is known as Ubeche Homestead. In fact, that is where King Dingane's mother lived.
And then as a result, when these number of kings' wives were on the monthly periods, they were not supposed to stay here. Instead, King Dingane instructed them to go up there into that particular village just to attend their private conditions, like monthly periods and so on. So that was to go hand in hand with a Zulu culture. Okay, thank you. So I explained that King Dingane was having 400 less privileged wives, so occupying the place which is known as the white section. So then here, we've got this section as well. That is a black section used by only 100 the good or the favorite wives of the king. So that is all, I mean, all of the huts have been restored or renewed on the same floors. Dingane's hut, of which it has been also restored on the same floor. The entrance, it is too low and then it is big. It is facing down there, downward, so that it can protect the rain from not coming inside. So if we can come in and have a look in the interior, please.
Okay.
Is it good?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So that is the interior of the king's hut. So we've got the floor. The floor has been here from 1829 when Mkungundlovu was established. So then the thing on the center, it's a fire making place, of which it was designed like a star. That was a special design for the king. Then the other huts were having the round fireplaces. So coming to these poles, you see the poles standing on here. So we talk about the supporting poles is insika in Zulu. When King Dingane was here, there were around about 22 of them, and all of these supporting poles were decorated with glass beads because King Dingane was very fond of beads. So coming into the story of beads, coming into this kind of a glass beads, so the beads were just traded all the way from Eastern Europe, and the other beads were made by the Zulus out of the ostrich eggs. They were getting the yolk, the interior there, the yolk was dried from there, it was cut into small pieces. Then the other beads were made out of copper. Okay, so the diameter of the hut is about 10 meters. They say that this hut was very big, so it can accommodate about 50 people just inside here. Okay. Then this is like a framework. This is this stuff has been done by the men. So this is a hut which has been made out of the saplings, or izindungo is like a timber or something. So then this is to show you how it looks like before it has been thatched. So the fungi, I mean to thatch, that is a function of the ladies or the women. King Dingane's village, I mean hut, indlu, or that is a private hut, that was the biggest of all. It has been redone on the same floor. And then this thing here, that is a kirkly enclosure or isibaya. Especially that was a very important kirkly enclosure, because that is where only the special calves of the king were just kept. We talk about the Nguni kirkly, and also we talk about those kirkly known as Inyoni Kaiphumuli, which has been interpreted as the bed never rest. So those were white special calves used or owned by the Zulu kings only. Okay. The front part, the front part of the floors. So we see that the entrances, all of the entrances are just facing downwards there, so that the rain could not come in. Is it fine?
Yeah.
All right, thank you. So this is like a little curio shop we have.
So we sell everything in this little Korea shop except myself. I'm not for sale. All right. Okay. So we sell all of these books, especially they are just dealing with Zulu culture, the history, the traditionals of, I mean, the traditions of the Zulus. So especially like this one, this is the most interesting book. It's A Rise and Fall of the Zulu Empire. It has been written by Alan Mountain, then forwarded by the current king, King Kudulzwelithini. So we've got this statue, this front cover, that is the statue of a king, a Shaka. Then the back cover here, we've got this logo or this organization. It's known as Amafa AKwaZulu Natal. It's a heritage KwaZulu Natal. It's like a private sector of which we are looking after the royal graves, the monuments, the historical sites, battlefields, and so on. So that is only 100 rand for the book. That is very, very informative. Therefore, just here, we've got the stuff that is... We are selling all of these small.
Afghan to the Russian and Shanks, Kazu, the Tassin Gang, Mundi, kunehlathi lapha ecinene silikhomba ukuthi sithi kusemthonjaneni emthonjaneni ke kunesiphetho la kwanze siphetho umthonjaneni ayehlale emntodo ngoba kuthiwa wathi mayihamba ngelinye ilanga wafica lesi siphetho kuze kuthiwa kusemthonjaneni ukuthi abelungu bayashintsha kamagama lapha ayakusemthonjaneni wathi mayifika wafika isiphetho sasimise lapha uyakwazi ukukhomba umgungundlovu lapha onduku sibomvu.